Welcome back to the Industrial Automation Insider Podcast. I'm Matt Van Bogart, business development person here in the Machine Vision business unit at Zebra. Happy to have Donato Montanari joining me today. He's the vice president and general manager of our Machine Vision business unit. And today we're going to have a conversation around the topics of a cloud, deep learning, etc. So first of all, Donato, thank you very much for taking time on your schedule to join us today. I appreciate that. Share with us kind of your view. You know, how do you see AI and cloud having an impact on computer vision and machine vision world?
Certainly. Well, first of all, Matt, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here and sharing this exciting thoughts regarding the future of vision. I think, you know, like if you look at historically and traditionally, the machine vision business and the machine vision technology, image processing has always been considered something very, very complex, very niche, difficult to attain. Primarily because really it's a lot of disciplines in one. You got optics, you got, you know, software, you got hardware, you got programming, you got a lot of things. So really the way that I look at deep learning and more in general, neural networks and including cloud training is an opportunity for simplifying the challenges related to the complexity of machine vision. So I see these tools as a way to democratize, if you wish, to use a little bit of a political word, right? Democratize machine vision, making it accessible, right? So if I'm a control engineer, right, and I know everything about my plant, I don't need a PhD in optics in order to install a camera. I think that's fundamentally the really big advantage of these new technologies related to this fact that they are somehow able to learn, right? And so they are somehow able to take out of the equation all these complicated skills that we just mentioned.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah, similar to you, I've seen this trend where companies, customers have been asking for, you know, easier to use solutions. So you don't have to necessarily be, you know, massively skilled and trained and have, you know, decades of experience with optics and software and machine vision. So I can definitely understand kind of where the draw of this technology is going. So let's talk a little bit about prem versus cloud. Of course, you know, traditionally, you know, machine vision has definitely been a prem service, and we're starting to see solutions develop, like some of the solutions we have leverage this combination of cloud and prem. Share us a little bit about kind of where the thought is around leveraging the cloud, and how can the cloud make some of these tools easier to use and easier to deploy, and in your words, you know, democratize the task of setting up a computer vision system.
Absolutely. So let me perhaps start with a distinction, right? When we talk about neural networks, deep learning, and the really two major distinct operations. One is you do the inspection, right? And the other one is you actually create this model, right? You teach this model the inspection that he has to do. So in terms of running the inspection, we strongly believe that this is something that you do on the edge. You do it on the line, right? It's going to be a processing unit. It's going to be an image acquisition device that physically at the line that will be able to acquire images and processes images very, very quickly. And it's going to be able to say if this part is okay or not okay, right? Now, the processing that runs on this edge device is a model which has been trained. Now the question becomes, how do you train this model? And it really depends on your organization, right? If you are a small organization and you have one factory, one line, or one factory, several lines, and then you can think, okay, I'm gonna have my own little server, and you know, I do all the training in this little server, and I'm self-contained, absolutely independent, and can build my own tools and so on and so forth. But as the organization and the scale of the organization grows, and you have several factories, several lines, and several business units with several factories, so on and so forth, it becomes very, very challenging to maintain all of these models. And typically what you'll see is that, you know, if you have, you know, five different lines building the same object, call it a, a bottle of shampoo or whatever that is, or a cogwheel, is exactly the same SKU for you, and you have, you know, five different lines in five different places, typically occurs that actually it's five different deep learning models, and each of those has been trained specifically in that line because of the environmental conditions, so on and so forth. So wouldn't it be nice to have only one model, right, that would work perfectly with all of these five different lines? And that's what cloud training can do to you. The ability that, you know, everyone can participate to the definition of this model, to the training on this model, submitting images from their lines and participating, you know, collaboratively in this training, really simplifies the management of the models. And this is huge. This is really, really huge, because typically, you know, every SKU as a model, and so the exponential growth is insane, right? So
So I can see, you know, the use cases, you know, that you're describing would be, you have a multinational company with facilities all over the world, and having this centralized system allows that high level of collaboration, right? Where the system gets better based upon the inputs that are given to it. So I could see this being a, you know, pretty powerful tool to help teams not only onboard new use cases, but also make existing use cases better, or in some cases, even sharing what others in an organization are doing. Is that one of the kind of drivers behind this kind of centralized technology, is that it becomes more of a team collaboration platform and system than something that's isolated on one line in a factory?
Absolutely true. And going back to, you know, the analogy of democratizing, right? You know, you start having a lot of engineers, you know, working together, you know, on the same problem, and sharing data, sharing information, sharing annotations. Let's not forget the importance of annotations in the performance of the model. I think that that's really, really important. Also because, you know, there are so many different stakeholders in an organization that need to be involved. Like, you know, the quality people, right? They, you know, they have to be able to look at something like, is it a pass or a fail, right? And now they can do it within the same system. The production managers and the people managing the SKUs. And so I think it really is the most important collaboration tool that an organization can deploy in order to be successful with deep learning. Otherwise, you're going to end up having, you know, all sorts of different localized models that they may work great for that one line, that particular specific SKU, but they don't scale. And you know, and multinational big corporations, they're all about scaling, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And also, I think what I'm used to seeing up until this point is that the compute requirements for deep learning algorithms are pretty intensive. And so having, you know, high power computer sitting everywhere in a factory for each individual use case just really doesn't make sense. What are the things that you're hearing directly from some of the customers that are approaching us about this, about, you know, this technology in general? What are they looking for? What type of benefits are they anticipating as they start to look at some of these solutions and looking at ways to scale it across their operations?
Right. I think there is two major advantages, or two reasons why multinationals are very interested in this deep learning cloud training ecosystem. The first one is that you can really do applications that you could not do before. So sometimes, and again, you know, this is a tool, so we should treat it as such. It's not like the universal solution for everything machine vision, right? But sometimes you have very challenging applications that are so complex that trying to define them rule-based is almost impossible. One very simple example is scratches. You know, how do you define a scratch? Right? They're all different. They're all different shape, different size, different thickness, right? So there are some kind of defects that are very hard for rule-based traditional programming and very easy for deep learning. And these are the applications where this company are very, very interested. You know, by the way, now I'm digressing a little bit. The opposite is also true. You know, there are some applications that are very simple rule-based. For instance, if you want to measure the distance between A and B, you don't need deep learning, right? Just use a ruler tool, right? So that's one, right? Being able to solve very complex applications that were very, very challenging before. And the second one is really, how can you simplify your deployment of machine vision? Because when you have a very complex vision application, it was really requiring customized hardware, customized software, special lensing, and all of that. And the interest for these companies to say, wait a minute, if we have this super powerful, right, processing algorithms called deep learning, can we not somehow be able to standardize on the hardware, like, you know, so that we can again scale, right? And maybe I overspec, right? But it's universal. I would say that these are the two main advantages that big corporations see in this technology. We always say cloud, but again, you know, a cloud could be an external cloud, but it could also be a cloud within a company, right? It could be your own cloud. So,
yeah, and it's interesting because there are, you know, definitely concerns about, you know, security, et cetera, you know, leveraging a cloud. So I think what you're saying is that the cloud, which is truly located somewhere, you know, no one knows exactly where it is. And then there is the version that is on-prem that could be used as a tool and system. And so I think we have customers coming to us basically asking for both types of solutions, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And it really depends on where the customer is coming from, what kind of previous experiences they've had with the cloud. You know, usually customers who are in the, let's say, in the consumer goods, they seem to have more, I would say, understanding how the cloud works, and they're more receptive to it. You know, customer who comes, you know, from a more traditional and cautious industry such as automotive and aerospace, they're obviously a little bit more skeptical, and they want to, you know, control everything within their own roof, which is fine, right? But what I do think is that, you know, the more that the cloud becomes part of our daily life, the more we'll see this being deployed also in manufacturing, because, you know, the new generations of engineers, they're so familiar with the cloud. They understand, you know, two-factor authorizations and managing users and all these things that are absolutely critical, you know, when you build the infrastructure for this.
Yeah. That also has me thinking is that, you know, companies that are on this journey of this convergence, that could have a pretty strong determining factor in terms of where they are, you know, looking towards the cloud for solutions. And I certainly understand, you know, some customer segments and verticals may be more sensitive or maybe earlier in that journey than, say, like the example that you use in a consumer products. And I guess there's no reason why, you know, companies couldn't do something on-prem for a period of time to get comfortable with a given solution before moving it someplace else.
Yeah.
So what are the drawbacks, I guess, to this type of model? Is it cost prohibitive for some customers? Is it a mindset thing? Is it just a new technology and customers, you know, might be hesitant? Are there, you know, specific myths that I think we will maybe able to dispel during this conversation?
I think that the main challenge that this deep learning have had in manufacturing is that customers tend to underestimate that this is a complex tool as well, right? It's not just something that comes for free. Like any other tool, right, there is a cost associated with it. And in this case, the cost is really understanding how the training is done. And, you know, customers tend to underestimate that. You know, typically the most scary thing that I hear about is this: oh, I'm so interested in deep learning, I'm going to get an intern for the summer and annotate all of my 275 screens. That is not a good way to start, right? You need the expertise. You need the expertise both of the quality control people who have seen these parts for, you know, years and years, and they know what is good and what is not good. You need a data scientist that can help you really understanding how you model this and what kind of percentage of good part versus bad part you want to have in your training set. You need a data scientist that generates synthetical images based on the few defects that you have, right? So you need to have that understanding. You need to have that knowledge. If you have that, then your ability to create models and to scale is very, very high. If you don't, right, then you'll fail. And it's going to be, everything's going to be very, very difficult. So I think that's the first one, right? The barrier to entry. People think that this can be done, you know, very, very quickly, very, very easily. It doesn't cost any money. The second one, I think, is that people tend to start with very complex problem, right? And they, you know, let's revolutionize our factory and be 100% AI-based. Well, just try to find scratches, right? And then when you've done that, you know, try to find holes, right? And so build it, right? Build it one use case at a time. So those two, in my opinion, are the I would say 80% of the reasons why people tend to not be happy when deploying deep learning and tend to have a lot of challenges. So my recommendation for deployment is find one problem that you want to solve that is very specific, that is, you know, easy to describe and to contain, and you can measure, right, the output of which you can measure. Usually quality control, you can measure pretty well. Then, you know, build a team. And what I mean by build is not necessarily hire a team, right? But work with partners and suppliers such as ourselves, right? Who can come in and help you out so that, you know, you start gaining confidence in this and so on and so forth.
Yeah. So where does this technology look like in 5 years, in your opinion? Is it evolving so quickly that it's almost impossible to determine what it's going to look like in 5 years? Kind of what are your thoughts on that problem?
It's very hard to say, to be honest. I mean, if you look at, just take, you know, ChatGPT 3.0 and 4.0, there are two different worlds. You know, that's the progress that they made from 3.0 to, you know, 4.0 is crazy. It's very, very hard to say. I think that the mistake that we don't want to keep doing is to think that AI is going to be the only thing that we're going to do, right? I think that, again, I'll go back to my point. You know, if you want to measure distances, if you want to drive a robot, you don't need AI. There are much better ways of doing it. So I think that we need to be a little bit careful in terms of the hype of this technology. Let's not forget that it's just a tool. And like any other tools, it's good to do what the tool is good to do, right? They cannot do everything. And that's what we call it, a toolbox, right? I mean, every craftsman has a toolbox, and the toolbox is more than one tool, by definition, right? And I think it's going to stay like that, right? I think that the number of tools in the toolbox is going to decrease exponentially because we have this one tool that takes most of it, but there still are going to be other instances, very important instances, where you just have to use rule-based.
Yeah. So if I hear you correctly, you're saying, you know, that this may not be for everyone. If it's not, continue to use the tools that have been proven for decades now.
Right.
But if this is something that kind of addresses those issues that we talked about up front, have a plan, build a team, you know, get your support system, and, you know, solve a more simple problem first and work into the technology. Is that kind of what you're saying?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, which is kind of, you know, at the end of the day, common sense, which you would do for any other technology, right? So this is not any different than any other technology.
Yeah, exactly. I think a lot of people are putting a lot of undue pressure on this technology, thinking it's going to solve everything, you know, solve every problem that they haven't been able to solve prior. And I think what you're saying is that, yeah, the technology is very innovative. It's very cutting edge. It's useful in a lot of use cases, but it's not the end all be all for everyone, for everything.
That's exactly what I'm saying.
Fantastic. Well, Donato, thank you very much for your time today. And I am Matt Van Bogart signing off from the Industrial Automation Insider Podcast. Thank you.
Thank you for that.